welcome to the video. And if it seems that we're kind of subdued, well, that's full stop in the wow mode. And that means that we're succeeding beyond our expectations. And the fact is that in this world, almost everyone fails dismally. And so when you realize you're succeeding, this is a tremendous shock to you. It's just like, wow. And it's hard to encompass it, because you look and say, well, why am I succeeding and everybody else is failing? What, you know, this is just incredible. It's amazing. The wow just reverberates, and we have to somehow accept it. Unfortunately, this is a time in the world where most are indeed failing dismally. Dismally, their heads have been turned to materialism, and they have just blanked out like a coma upon the basic truths of the situation. You can go back to Buddha and the Four Noble Truths about dukkha, suffering. All is suffering. Impermanence is suffering. All is inherently unsatisfactory here, and yet there is a way to get free of that. All is inherently unsatisfactory here. This is absolutely true. And yet we're all pretending here in this world that somehow the world can satisfy us, which is, you know, just the depths of madness. And we call that winning, succeeding. Yeah, it's upside down here, upside down and backwards. So as we succeed in freeing ourselves from suffering, the inherent suffering of impermanence, it's a shock. It's a shock because we're sort of, you know, there's it's not happening so much right here. It's not happening like that. But what can we do? What can we do? We just have to do it anyway. So we try to, we stay pretty subdued, and I've been in, you know, shock, in the wow phase all morning and all last night, and you know, it's continuous. And but what is most important is to continue to go as fast as possible. There's simply, do not spare yourself the push. So we will push forward in this video as fast as possible. Because what is today? March 5th? This is when Sirius Explorer locks into geosynchronous orbit with the dwarf planet Ceres, the water planet Ceres. And this has some sort of very symbolic meaning as far as a timing mechanism. It's something that's been pointed out to me. And it's somehow, there's some great relevance to this. And I've been aiming for this day, knowing that it's has this importance in some ways that we don't quite understand yet. So on this day, I said, you know, wow, I'm kind of frustrated. I haven't gotten to where I want to get to. Well, we still need to push as fast as possible. So I was in this traffic jam, as we get into the meat of this video here. Terrible traffic jam. You know, it's just, the traffic was just, it's one of these things. We have areas now that are like traffic jams almost all day long. And anyway, I was just sitting there and creeping along. And I was working on clarification. What's the next step? Come on, I don't care how much burn it causes. You know, let's get to it. I'm willing to eat the hottest pepper today. You know, just no matter how hard it is, I'm going to eat it. And just pay, you know, whatever the price is, I'll pay it. And I looked at the trees on the side of the freeway and the grass and everything. And then it came to me that this tree has never been born. This tree's never been born, actually. I was thinking about, I've never been born. That's what I was thinking about. I've never been born. What's the key to free? So I need to free from death, free from death? No. You need to be free from birth. The goal is not freedom from death. This has distracted us. The goal is realization, is freedom from birth, that you've never been born. That is key. I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. So how could I ever be born? Meaning defined. I've never been defined. And then I looked at nature, and I was able to recognize nothing has ever been born. In fact, none of this is definition at all. And I said, now we're getting somewhere. This is Shankara. World seen as world is misery. World seen as God is bliss. Okay. This is the true differentiation that we have to get to. And so we are getting to it. We are getting to it. So I felt this and I said, okay, wow. Let it settle in. Nothing's ever been born. Nothing is an ever been born, which is absolutely true, because everything is merely the appearance based on appearances based on our desire that they appear. But in reality, nothing's ever born. In other words, nothing ever crystallizes, to use Longchenpa's term. Nothing ever crystallizes, actually. Never. So there's never been any birth of anything whatsoever, ever. Not a world, not a person, not a plant, not a mineral. Nothing has ever been born. That means everything is God still. Everything is still God. And this is what the great sages have seen. Everything is God. There's nothing but God. That's all there is. That's all there is. And in God, nothing is ever born. All is absolute freedom. Okay, freedom from any definition whatsoever, actually. This is reality. So this situation we call, if this is reality, we're still in reality, actually. Nothing's ever been born. But we have given this plausible dance of appearances and tried to say that this is all, these are all things that have been born. Not true. We've just been defining it that way for ourselves. So right there is a very good step, but I'm saying, okay, that's great. I'm fine with that. But where's the real hot pepper? You know, that's not so hot. That's great, but I'm willing to go through any intensity of burn, you know, today of just and this should be our attitude right now, is a willingness to, okay, if something, a clarification comes in, then there's something in us that's just, can't stand that. So we're going to stand it. And one of us is going to leave, you know, that kind of feeling. Well, one of us is going to leave, and the one that can't stand it is going to leave, have to leave. Can't stand this insight, this truth. But this nothing has ever been born, that's a strong one. It should be for everybody to realize that nothing has ever been born. This does cause within us some aspect of us. I'm feeling the burn, starting to feel the burn now as I'm talking about this. Something's just very upset about that. Doesn't matter what it is. It's a lie. It's a lie is all it is. And of course, the ego, which is the one who hides lies from us and makes them seem like they're plausible truths, is very upset because it's one of, you know, one of its precious babies, one of its precious lies, is now being brought to light. And the ego doesn't like that at all. So it's burning with consternation because it wants us to start thinking about it and start that way burying it and hiding it again. And we say, no, I'm not going to think about it at all. I've already seen it clearly. It's already true. And so I just need to enjoy and appreciate and be impressed, experience feelings impressed by getting to this. So just full stop in the wow is what I need to do. See, the ego doesn't like the full stop in the wow, which is why it's not used hardly ever, which is why it has been difficult to get this into the practice. But it's essential as you allow yourself to feel impressed and feel, wow, this is quite a great insight I have now. Nothing's ever been born. And just marinate in that. Let it soak in. And the ego is desperate to pull you and start spinning it in some way, either by congratulating you. Let's talk about this, you know, like interviewing you. Hey, you just heard you had this great insight. Let's talk about this insight now. What, you know, how did you get this insight? How did you come? What, give me some of your background here. You know, like as if you're some celebrity. Wow, you're some celebrity. Let me interview you. And so you think, oh wow, the ego's really wants me to talk about and publicize this. Oh great. Okay, well how did I get this insight? Well, let me see now. And you start trying to figure out, well, how did I put this together historically so I can put a nice little narrative here so somebody can write an article on me or something. And before you know it, you're all tangled up in confusion and consternation. You've lost the feeling. You've lost the clarity. This is the ego operating. The ego acts as if it's your publicity director, right? And says, wonderful, you have this great insight. Now I'm going to publicize this, so I know my job, how to get it out to people and help people understand. So you need to give me some filler here so I can do that. And before you know it, you're completely confused, upset, lost your momentum, your spiritual will feels crushed. These are the tricks of the ego. Full stop in the wow means, publicity director, don't bother me. Okay. And the publicity director is, of course, over there kibitzing you, saying, oh my God, you know, you're missing your big opportunity here. This could be it. This could be the big story. You know, you're just saying, don't bother me. So when you do full stop in the wow, be cognizant of this, your publicity director, publicity for you, and how clever it is to try and flatter you and get you to think that it's to your advantage to try and explain, think. Remember, when we say full stop in the wow, it means don't go back. Just don't try to remember what it is that you saw. You've already seen it. You've already seen it. Now, it's like there's a brand new car in your driveway. You come out in the door in the morning, you look, and there's a brand new car in the driveway, and it's yours. Well, you may just sit down on a bench somewhere and just quietly just, you know, go into full stop in the wow mode. Just no slouch, but you're not even looking at the car at all for quite some time. Because you see it, you realize it, it dawns upon you. Wow, this is my new car. I have a new car. So we don't have to do anything about that. That's already done. What we need to do is adjust our psyche so that it fits that car. It's kind of like you have like this beautiful Land Rover, nice new Land Rover, and you're driving that for a while, and then you decide, hey, you know what? I'm going to trade this Land Rover in, and the next day you show up in a brand new Bentley, you know, the newest Bentley. You got to get used to it. So that's what we're doing. We're moving up into the Bentley class right here, the spiritual Bentley class. And so, yeah, even though you're used to the Land Rover, having that Bentley in your driveway, you just kind of like sit there and just go, wow. You don't have to look at it. You know it's there. But you're concentrating on some sort of global upheaval within your psyche. That's more important. Once that calms down, then, you know, take the Bentley for a spin. You know, the insight, the recognition, nothing's ever been born. All is God. That's a very key insight there. And the truth is still true. You know, if that's true, then it's true right now. But we can take a little bit of time to appreciate getting there and the shock it is to be able to entertain such an idea. You know, what we're doing is we're entertaining ideas, entertaining clarity. And so I call the channel Christ Clarity. Christ meaning the oneness that already is, that all is God, all is just this one God. Entertaining this clarity is what we do. And maintaining our composure, working on maintaining our composure is what we do. So imagine every day you got up in the morning, there's a better car in your driveway, brand new, shining, and it's way better than the one you had yesterday. And every you get up, next day, same thing. And then you just, you know, wow. And this is what it feels like. Every day, have a better car. Not stressful, isn't it? Absolutely. It's way more stressful than someone who gets up every day and it's the same car. They're used to it and, okay, keep driving that same car. But for those who want to extricate themselves from a self-deception, we have to go through this stress, this pressure of a new car every day. That's the difficulty of the path. People think, why is it so difficult? Well, just try getting a brand new car every day. So that each one's much better than the last. At some point, you know, you're going to feel like, wow, I don't know if I can keep doing this. This is too much. And so this is where, you know, the discipline comes into play. Very important that we have some basic conventions that we can fall back on. Because at some point, we feel like this is just so amazing. I don't know if I can keep going. But we have these discipline and basic conventions. You can keep that going. And so what you do is you keep some momentum going. And that is enough to turn the tide. It's enough to keep it going. It's enough to keep it going. So if you practice it, well, I have to practice every day. I'm going to sit quietly every day. I know I'm going to sit straight. I'm going to face forward like this. I'm going to be severely modest. I'm not going to slouch, not going to goof off. Severely modest. And spend a chunk of time. And then the basic convention, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. You have these basic conventions. So you can keep the momentum going, even when there's this new dazzling vehicle in your driveway this morning. And you say, well, that might be just too much for me, but I do have these conventions, and I know I can do those. So let's just do those and do the best we can. See how it goes. Because I'm not going to quit no matter what. So, you know, I have to have an attitude like, well, you know, somehow I'm going to adjust to this new vehicle. Someday I'll be able to adjust to it. And just keep the conventions going. So this is the wisdom of the spiritual path, by having some conventions without stifling yourself in them. See, this, it's part convention, part creativity, right? Is have some conventions without stifling yourself. When you stifle yourself, with conventions, you stagnate. And when you stagnate, the wheels start coming off and you start backsliding and you end up turning your faith back into believing that what God has created can be changed. And this is the central delusion that we're suffering from. So pay the price of success, which is daily practice, adhering to a set of conventions, not too many. We don't have too many here. It's very simple. Just, you know, don't let yourself slouch when you're practicing. And don't goof off. Don't get goofy when you're practicing. You know, keep yourself quiet, hands to hands, basically. Keep yourself quiet. A little sip of water, something, you know, sip of water when you need it. And then practice the convention of assertion, full stop in the wow, flipping the script. Okay? That's pretty much it. But practice those conventions so you have those conventions. And then you can recognize in a flash of insight, wow, nothing's ever been born. Everything is God. And then you say, well, that's not too much for me. I still have these conventions, and I know I can carry on with those. the Zen saying, you know, what do you do before enlightenment? You're chopping wood and carrying water. What do you do after enlightenment? You're chopping wood and carrying water. This means convention. You have certain conventions in your practice, and you can carry those through. They won't leave you. When you have no conventions at all, then it makes it too difficult, because you end up, if you have an insight, you end up then searching for some stability. And you know, conventions are not stability if you don't practice them. They become your rock of stability. The more you practice them, the more you're convinced yourself, I can do this, I can do this. And so you know you've got to go to place, right? You've got somewhere to go for stability. And then you can have an insight like, wow, the whole world, nothing's ever been born. In fact, what I'm looking at right now is not a picture of anything ever being born whatsoever. It's actually God, the unborn. All is already the unborn. All, yes, I already know that all is already the unborn, the unattainable. Okay, now let's look at this word, unattainable. Let's say you have something. Okay. Soft drink can. Okay, what is it? It's a soft drink can. That's what it is, okay? This is what it is. Now, does this soft drink can need to attain anything to be a soft drink can? Aluminum can. Does it need to attain anything? No, it's already an aluminum soft drink can. That's what it already is, okay, for example. So, attainment means change, right? Attaining a change in what is. Think about that. Now, if we were to crush this, we could say, well, I attained a crushed can. The crushed can is an attainment of mine. But if the can stays exactly the same, how can we speak of attainment? You know, it already is this. If we take this as something that inherently is, there's no attainment at all involved in that. So in order to speak of attainment at all, we're talking about attaining change. They're synonymous. Attaining change, change and attainment are actually synonymous. I saw this today. I'd never seen that before. I said, wow, yeah. If we don't change at all, how can we speak of attainment? If nothing changes, how can we speak of attainment? If nothing's ever been born, how can we speak of the attainment of something being born? Like I've attained birth. I've managed to attain birth. If there isn't any such thing, how can we attain it? So we say, yes, I already know that I am already that which is unattainable. That means I'm already that which is unchangeable. Because we talk about attainment, we mean attaining, bringing about a change in something. Out of this clay, I attained this clay pot that I made. This is an attainment. I changed the structure, the form, the definition of something. But how can we speak of attainment if you haven't changed anything at all? And everything just inherently is the way it is. It doesn't make any sense to say, well, I attained no change, because no change is already the case. There's no attainment there. So attainment always is relating to change. So if we say, yes, I already know that I'm already exact that which can never be attained, we're saying I'm already that which can never be changed. So certainly, we cannot attain what we are. The whole idea of attaining what we are means making a change in something, somehow changing, and that change produces what we are. This is insanity. Okay, this is what we're struggling against, to free ourselves from this delusion. that we can attain the self, attain what we are. No, we're already that which is unattainable. We're already that which is unattainable. Now, it's enough to just feel this and feel the burn of this, not to say, well, oh, yeah, I understand this intellectually, or we can glimpse that, but it's spiritually we know this is true, so it affects us. We feel this, you know, sort of a shock of recognition, actually. I am, yes, I know. Yes, I already know that I'm already that, which can never be attained. It's like a climber saying, a rock climber climbing up a mountain saying, hey, I attained the summit, meaning I reached the summit. Well, did the summit attain the summit? Did the mountain attain the summit? No. The summit was already the summit. There's a mountain. The summit didn't have any attainment. The climber, attaining it means the climber is in a different place than it was previously. Change of locale. So that locale is now the summit. So I attained a new locale, being the summit. But can everywhereness, can everywhereness attain a new locale? Can the allness attain a new locale? Can the oneness attain a new locale? Can it attain? What can it attain? What can reality attain? Reality is not a situation of attainment. It's a situation of isness. So, yes, I already know that I am already that which is unattainable. I am already that which is unattainable. And our problem is we're putting ourselves in the role of an attainer. An accomplisher, an achiever. I already know that what I am. I am that which can never be achieved. Yes, I already know. I am that which can never be accomplished. Yes, I already know. I'm already that which can never be attained. So this certainly causes consternation within our previous belief system of achievement, attainment, accomplishment. Yes, I already know that what I am that. Yes, I already know that I am that which can never be accomplished. So when we put ourselves in the role of an accomplisher, trying to accomplish ourselves, trying to achieve what identity, trying to accomplish identity, trying to acquire identity, this is a self-delusion. So the ones who are trying to do that motivate themselves by insisting that this is the only, an accomplished identity is the only identity there is. The identity of achievement is the only identity there is. And basically they say we're a work in progress, an aggregate that is being built up until it finally accomplishes true identity. And that if you don't do this, you won't have any identity at all. This is, you know, utter folly, total delusion, self-deception. Yes, I already know. I am already that which can never be accomplished. I'm already that which can never be achieved. Yes, I know, I'm already that which can never be acquired. How can you say you can acquire everywhere? Oh yeah, just acquired everywhere. What acquired everywhere? Something outside of everywhere? Acquired everywhere? No, it's nothing outside of everywhere. So, I am not acquired, I am not achieved. I am unachievable, I am unacquirable, I am unaccomplishable, I am unattainable. I am that. Yes, I already know that I am that which is unattainable. Yes, I already know that I am that which is unaccomplishable. Yes, I already know I am that which is unachievable. Yes, I already know that I am that which is unacquirable. I am that which is unborn, eternally unborn. I am that which is inherently unborn, forever unborn. All is unborn. All is unborn. All is unborn. Yes, I already know that all is already unborn. All is already unborn. It's not accomplishing the unbornness. That's why I say already. So for all these A words, acquiring, accomplishing, achieving, aligning, accomplishing, acquiring, achieving, various A words. The A word that causes all those to evaporate is already. I am already that which can never be accomplished. I'm already that. Yes, I already know that I'm already that which can never be accomplished. Yes, I already know I am already that can never be achieved. Yes, I know I am already that can never be acquired. And I'm already, yes, I already know I'm already that which can never be born. Yes, I already know I am that which can never be born. Now, it may seem that this is very, very tough teaching, but no. What does tough mean? It means it produces this burn in us, right? Like, well, great. This is what we like. This is what we want. This is full stop in the wow. This is the wow. So we recognize the wow is meaning we're really succeeding here. This is great. Yes, I already know that I am that which can never be aligned. Can never be aligned, acquired, accomplished. Attained, aligned, acquired, accomplished, attained, never be attained, achieved. Okay, accomplished, attained, achieved, aligned, acquired. There's five right there. Yes, I already know that I am that which can never be aligned. Yes, I already know that I am that which can never be accomplished. Yes, I already know I am that which can never be acquired. Yes, I already know I'm already that which can never be aligned. And yes, I already know I'm that which can never be achieved. Aligned, accomplished, acquired, achieved, and attained. Aligned, accomplished, acquired, achieved, attained. Aligned, accomplished, acquired, attained, achieved. Yes, I already know I'm not that which can be aligned, acquired, accomplished, attained, or achieved. Aligned, accomplished, attained, acquired, or achieved. The five A's. I'm already that. I am already that which can never be aligned, accomplished, acquired, attained, or achieved. Yes, I am already that which can never be aligned, accomplished, acquired, attained, or achieved. And in order to align, accomplish, acquire, attain, or achieve, we have to have something which is somehow not already unattainable, unalignable, unachievable, unacquirable, unaccomplishable. Align, acquired, accomplished, attain, or achieve, unattainable, unacquire, achievable. We have to have something that is already outside of that, and we call that a birth. We think we've been born into a condition which then can be returned, and we claim that this is accomplishment, it's an alignment, it's an accomplishment, it's an achievement, it's an attainment, it's an acquirement. So first we have to have that which we say we can change. So we can say, look at this achievement. I took this and turned it into this. Okay, but this is self-delusion. The truth is, we can never be born. We can never be other than what God created us to be, which is the everywhere, allness, oneness. We can never be outside of that. We can never be born. We can never be other than that. So we can never be other than how God created us. So how can we say that we can be born? We're not born, we're created. So what we see in this world is not the dance, is a dance of creation, not the dance of bornness, not the dance of things, not the dance of nature, actually. Because I've said there is no world, there is no nature, none of that exists. World as world doesn't exist. Nature as nature doesn't exist. Does not exist. A dance of creation is quite a different story than a dance of born things. A very different perspective. So it's a question of shifting our perspective off of world as world onto God as world. Now, where do you think this contemporary culture is taking us? I read this, something came to my attention, the Holy Spirit pointed out to me, where there's this new theory out now that is gaining momentum, and that it says that smartphones are now being seen as an intrinsic part of being human. An intrinsic part of being human, of being. Smartphones are an intrinsic part of being human. And I thought about it. I said, you know, that's right. This is true. This is quite accurate what they're saying. It's an intrinsic part of being human. It's also an intrinsic part of viewing world as world. Okay, it's even more intrinsic to that. Being human is an intrinsic part of believing that the world is a world, that nature is nature, the world is a world. And so smartphones being now a sort of a new intrinsic part of being human, meaning this is how humans remain human, as it were, remain in the belief. This is how the belief that the world is a world is maintained at this point. It's an intrinsic part of now the defense system of the belief in human being, humanness, which is, of course, blindness to God as world. So you might say the smartphone is an intrinsic part of being blind, maintaining blindness, and maybe even increasing the blindness. Which is why I don't have a smartphone. Holy Spirit said, no, 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 no. You don't want that. And now more, I'm seeing more and more and more and more and more how wise a decision that is. Remember, to be human means to be blind. To be human means to be blind to truth. To believe that you are a human means to, for you, it's a defense system. The whole belief in bodies and world, nature, is a defense system to defend you, to give you an option that you can fixate on and believe that God isn't God. You see, that somehow God has been made lesser than God, that God has been turned into a world, been born as things, as world bodies and stuff. But if you see God as world, then it's an entirely different perspective, and you realize, no, God hasn't changed in the slightest bit. It's always just been God. Nothing's ever been born. Nothing's ever been born out of the oneness, out of the allness, out of the isness. There's never been any time, space, process, or form at all, actually. None. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. There's never been any time, space, process, or form. I have never been born. There's never been any time, space, process, or form. Yes, I already know that I've never been born. There's never been any time, space, process, or form. And yes, I know. Yes, I already know that I've never been born. Yes, I already know that nothing has ever been born. Now again, in this fourth phase practice that we're doing, which is this high practice, this is all, we're allowing this in intuitively, we know this is true, and we're allowing it to impact us, to permeate us, which causes this the ego to just drives it nuts. It wants to leave. And we say, fine, anytime you want to leave, it's no problem. I'm not, the door's wide open. This puts falsity under so much pressure. I can't stand it. It's like cockroaches. You turn the light on and they're running for the darkness. So as you bring the light of truth into your being, let it shine in your being, the cockroaches of egoic defensiveness can't stand it. They absolutely cannot stand it. And they're scurrying, fleeing to find some land of darkness, some place of darkness they can hide. And of course, there are plenty of people who welcome them in. These psychic parasites will welcome, oh yeah, come on in, there's plenty of darkness here. You know, let this be a den of iniquity. But right now we're driving out all this, all these terrible cockroaches, driving them out, letting them, we're bringing about their departure because we're shining the light of truth within us, and they can't stand it. So all the squatters are leaving, you know, the squatters camp that has been sucking all your energy, vitality, and functionality out of you. That squatter's camp is being broken up now, and they're all grabbing their bags and scurrying away somewhere, you know, into some other darkness, someplace that'll harbor the darkness and their, you know, iniquity. So just let them go. Just keep shining this light. Keep shining the light. Keep shining this light. This is the technique. The technique. Now this isn't some, this isn't some prototypical historical technique necessarily. We don't have to align it as such. But in truth be told, there's been innumerable various techniques used throughout history. So many so that it's futile to try to categorize them or waste your time on all that. What's important is right here, right now, shine the light of truth within your being. And of course, that which can't stand that is going to leave. Very simple. Stop in the wow. We generate this spiritual, you know, the shock of recognition. And we just get used to it. And of course, next time, then it'll be a lot easier. We don't have to intellectually figure out how nothing's been born through molecules and chemicals and atoms and all this theory. We merely assert the truth, and that which is in disagreement with it flees from us. You see, this is how we save time. Keep asserting the truth and saying, no, I agree with this entirely, 100%, not backing off at one bit. And then this causes that which disagrees to, it's got no choice, there's no dialogue there, it's got no choice but to leave. Got no choice but to leave. And I sort of sense that seeing that there's nothing's ever been born, it's all just God. This will be a huge relief for us. This is the sense I had, that we'll really be able to relax then. Huge relief. Wow. Looking forward to that. Yes, I already know that this tree has never been born. So as you're driving down the road, here's an exercise. I'm trying to consider, you know, how to help everyone in their lives. And in today's life, what is something that is pretty much intrinsic to everybody's life? Driving. Okay. Now in the past, they didn't have, you know, that. Maybe it was walking, right? But today is driving. So how do you practice while driving? How do you practice while driving? Well, anything you see as you're driving, you say, yes, I already know that this has never been born. Yes, I already know this tree has never been born. Yes, I already know this is not a born tree. Yes, I already know that this is not a born road. Yes, I already know that this is not a born sidewalk. Yes, I already know that those are not born people. Yes, I already know this is not a born plant. And everything you see, yes, I already know. You know, and saying, yes, I already recognize, yes, I already know that is not a born sign. Yes, I already know this sign has never been born. Yes, I already know this tree has never been born. This is not a born tree. Yes, I already know that is not a born house. Yes, I already know that is not a born mountain. Yes, I already know that is not a born sky. Yes, I already know that is not a born car. Yes, I already know this is not a born street. You can practice that way of just identifying everything you see. Say, no, that is not a born. Nothing has ever been born. Nothing ever is born. Nothing ever is born. Yes, I already know that nothing ever is born. Don't explain it to the ego. The ego is just, let it burn. Let the ego burn. What it wants to do, all the ego wants you to do is for you to stop asserting this. So it'll pretend to an olive branch to you, you know, say, well, wow, I'm really impressed. Let's talk about this. You know, maybe you can convince me. Don't bother. We don't want to convince the ego of anything. We want the ego to leave. We want self-deception to leave. And seeing the world as world is certainly self-deception. So there's no, we don't want any dialogue with lies. Lies can never be true. We just want them to leave. And the best way to get them to leave is keep asserting it. Full stop on the wow. Then flip the script and assert it some more. A cat was sleeping, and I disturbed its sleep. So it came over, hello kitty, how are you? And the cat said, huh? I was sleeping. I said, yeah, you're going to be sleeping all day long here, right? How about getting up and going outside or something? So after a little while, the cat decided, hey, yeah, I think I'll go outside. So now it's outside moving around, you know, no longer dreaming. So we do have to disturb our sleep in a nice way. I came over and just patted the kitty, said, hey, nice kitty, how are you today? And the cat, woke up from the dream. What? And then I said, yeah, don't you want to be outside today? And So by asserting the truth, we're waking ourselves up. And of course, we first may see startled, said, oh, I kind of wanted to just keep on sleeping. I mean, you know, I don't want to, do I have to move around? Yeah. Oh, okay. And then you think, oh, yeah, it's better to be awake than asleep. It's better to be, to know the truth than to be trying to deceive ourselves. So, of course, the act of waking up is not so much an intellectual act. You know, it's deeper than that. So, these assertions, yes, I already know that tree has never been born. Yes, I already know that's an unborn tree. Yes, I already know that's an unborn shrub. Yes, I already know that everything is already unborn. Yes, I already know that this is an unborn street. Yes, I already know that all is God. You know, these help wake us up, because they're so absolute, right? And we realize this is an absolute change of perspective that you might say is like waking up. It's, you know, it's similar. They use the metaphor of waking up from when you're sleeping and then you wake up, and you say, "Wow, this." You know, we do it every morning. It's like, "Wow, this is." I completely forgot about this world when I was sleeping. And then, whoa, here it is again. Wow, it's always kind of like a surprise. To see God as the world is a major shift from seeing world as world. So the metaphor is like from waking up from sleeping, but it's not exactly that at all. That's a metaphor. And you know, when you someone wakes you up and you're drowsy, you don't want to get up, you keep your eyes closed, right? Even though you're awake, you keep your eyes closed. And so just imagine, for as a metaphor, spiritual awakening is like where you this fourth phase is like we're awake, but we still have our eyes closed. You know, we don't want to quite open them yet and see the day, see the world, right? We kind of say, yeah, I know I need to get up, but I'm just going to keep my eyes closed for a while and sit here. But everything else is feeling like, yeah, I can function. I'm ready to function. I just don't want to open my eyes yet. And then finally we say, okay, got to open my eyes. And it's sort of like this final will-like decision is, okay, you know, got to open my eyes now. And then you open your eyes. So, but it makes it a lot easier to get out of bed in the morning if you already feel awake, even though your eyes may still be shut. So what we're doing here is we're waking up to truth. We're waking up to truth even though our eyes are still closed. Once we wake up to truth very strongly, you know, so the only factor that is not yet awake to truth, it's just the eyelids are shut. At some point, we'll open our eyes and then we'll see it. It's like that. Then our attention will relax as truth. So, but we're not trying to force our eyelids open. What we're doing is we're trying to get the rest of us. You know, when you wake up, you might get aches and some arms sort of asleep, and you need to stretch, and you get, you know, and at some point you've stretched and you're ready, you know, now you feel fully ready to function. It's just your eyes are still shut. That's it. And then at some point you'll say, okay, I'm confident enough to open my eyes, and then you'll open your eyes. So this is exactly what we're doing here, is we keep building up this fitness, ready. I say ready to get up, ready to get up, ready to get up. And yes, your eyes are still shut, so we can't quite see that God is world. That's a hummingbird. Nice. Interesting. But we're so close, getting so close to saying, you'll say, okay, time to open our eyes. Because all the rest of us is all ready and fit, right? Whereas if we open our eyes first and look down and we're not ready to get up, we might say, ah, I don't feel like getting up. I'm going to close our eyes again and go back to sleep. But if we wake everything else up first, then we can't go back to sleep, really, right? And so what's the use of keeping our eyes closed at that point? So then we'll say, oh, yeah, I can't go back to sleep because my heartbeat, respiration, everything else is you know, ready to go, so I might as well open my eyes. So opening our eyes is the last thing that happens. It's the last thing, and that just sort of happens on its own once just everything else is made ready. This is the discipline on the path. Many people try to force their eyes open, and then being overwhelmed by what they see. What the problem is that they feel like, but I'm not quite ready to, you know, get into that. And then they say, well, then so like, you know, the body's still asleep pretty much. So I'll just close my eyes again, and they go doze right back off. They're still in doze mode. So we got to get out of doze mode, but keep our eyes closed until that's the last step. Don't try to open our eyes in doze mode and then we'll just close them again, and just easy then to go back to sleep. Easy to go back to sleep. So I feel this is a useful metaphor, really. And so we can say, yes, I already know. I mean, this is part of the waking up. But we realize that the eyes are still shut. Well, that's okay. I mean, I already know that I'm awake. I'm aware that I'm awake. I already know that I'm already enlightened. I already know. And the more we practice this, the more we get everything awake except just our perception. And at some point our perception will just merely shift. That's all. Just merely shifts. Just. And if we realize that's the last part, the easiest part now, that we've everything else has already shifted, it's just our perception hasn't quite shifted. All our concepts have shifted, all our expectations have shifted, all our clarity has shifted, everything, our belief has shifted, our faith has shifted, everything else has shifted. And the last to shift is just this shift of perception where we realize, oh, now I'm perceiving God as world. Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm ready for that. This headset is hurting me for some reason. Yeah, no problem. This is the smart way. This is the fast way. It seems indirect, but doesn't it? But it's not indirect because it goes the quickest way. Let's say, well, here's an example. Let's say you're on the freeway and there's this huge bottleneck and you realize it. And you say, wait a minute, if I go turn off the freeway here, go on this side street, and this street, and this street, this street, this street, okay, turn here, and then I get to where I want to go. Well, is that the most direct way? Or is staying on the freeway, that bottleneck, which might take you 10 times longer, is that the most direct way? Well, it depends on what you mean is direct. If the definition of direct, it means the quickest way, then staying on the freeway is not the quickest way. So you could call it pragmatically a very indirect way. The meaning of getting somewhere in directness means intrinsically has a meaning of it's the most expedient, quickest way. It's the quickest way. So by leaving the shift of perception as the last step, we're actually going the quickest way, the most direct way. Whereas trying to force a shift of perception before we are ready for it will just put us back into another sleep. And so how can that be said to be the most direct way to true awakening? Just catching a glimpse is not the awakening. It's not the abiding. It's not the awake state. It's a glimpse. A glimpse is a glimpse. So this morning I was just trying out, hey, how would it be if I saw everything as not born, as never having been born, as unborn? Everything is in the unborn condition. This is an unborn tree. This is an unborn hedge. This is an unborn sidewalk. Those are unborn rocks. Nothing has ever been born. And I said, yeah, that'd be great. That means everything is God. Different way of perceiving. But you see, we perceive what we want to perceive, what we desire to perceive. So perception is not primary. It's very much like it's an effect. It's secondary. So once we change what it is we want to perceive, then the final step is for perception to shift. So perception is not causal. So trying to make perception first is to confuse cause and effect. Let the shift in perception be the last step. That's why the world is confused. It keeps saying, well, you haven't changed your perception. You haven't done anything. What are you doing? You're wasting your time. No. The shift in perception is the final step. Everything else is the preliminaries. It's like saying that putting in the front door of a house should be the first step. No, it's the last step. Once you build a house, you do everything else, and then maybe you put in the front door, and then people can say, oh, I've got a house now. But what if you don't have any house at all, you just put a front door there? I mean, what is that? even if you just put a front door and built around it, you still have to build the whole rest of the house, wouldn't you? So you can't say it's done. So the wow is sometimes it feels like jitteriness, like desire to stop. I gotta get away from this. You know, I gotta get away from this. There's no, when you're trying to flee like that, it's you're fleeing from the wow. So it's better to embrace the wow. Say, great, let me just sit with it here. This avoids an enormous amount of trouble. I'm jittery. Great. I want to flee. Okay, wonderful. Just sit here and enjoy that feeling. So yes, I already know. I have never been born. Yes, I already know nothing's ever been born. Yes, I already know there's never been any birth whatsoever. Nothing has ever been born. Yes, I already know that all of this is unbornness. This is another way of saying, yes, I already know that everything is already here-ness and now-ness. Yes, I already know that everything is already here-ness and now-ness. And this is seeing God as the world. Yes, I already know that everything is already here-ness and now-ness. This is the simple shift that will occur, and this is what the great sages have told us. This is what we can do, and this is what we must do. Very simple. Shift from world as world to God as world. Shift your perception. But first we shift our beliefs, expectations. So what mode are we in now in practice? Full stop mode. Because we are bringing to light what the ego finds to be intolerable. The whole notion of birth is essential for the ego, because only then can the aids come into play. The alignment, acquirement, accomplishment, attainment, and the other one, what is it? Those are the ones that come into play. Achievement, yeah. All the A's come into play. which is what the ego is all about. Of course, the ego is the one that is advising us on how to align, how to accomplish, how to acquire, how to attain, and how to achieve. That's its role, is to advise us. And then when we say that nothing's ever been born, there is no role for the ego at all. Yes, I already know that everything is already unborn, never born. This is the never born tree. That is the never born sky, the unborn sky. So this is a very different way of accepting the world, and then from this acceptance will ultimately come a perception that backs it up. And you will say, yeah, I see it, I see it, I see it. So we see what we believe. We see what we believe in terms of this is perception. So we've been using perception in a very negative way, which is try and perceive as if everything is born and therefore subject to the five A's: alignment, acquirement, accomplishment, attainment, achievement. So we can say, yeah, we can be the our own creator. Say, yeah, I created myself. I took this, what was born, and then turned it into something, you know, immortal or something like that. This is our belief. And this is false. We're already eternal. I am that which is already eternal and can never be attained. I am already that which, yes, I already know that I'm already that which can never be attained. Yes, I already know I am already that which can never be attained. So just hold your ground with the ego. It's trying to make me very drowsy now, very drowsy. Just hold your ground. This just takes the ego out of play entirely. And so the ego say, well, I want to be in play somewhere else. I'm going to go help someone out who wants to attain, wants to accomplish, wants to acquire, wants to align, wants to achieve. I'm going to go to some achiever. Not you. You're a loser. I say, how can I be a loser? I've never been born. Don't you have to be born first to be a loser or a winner? Winner meaning you've achieved something. Loser hasn't achieved. If I've never been born, how can I have a need to achieve what I am if I'm already that which is unattainable? So, I'm already that which is unachievable. I'm already that which is unacquirable. I'm already that which is unaccomplishable. I'm already that which is unalignable. So I don't need to win. So the ego saying it's going to go help somebody else win. Go ahead. Be my guest. Here's the door. The ego says, you'll never achieve anything anything status. I say, that's right. Don't need to. There aren't any things. So basically you're saying you'll never attain the status of nothing. Well, there's already nothing, no things. I'm already no thingness. All is already no thingness. So we don't need to attain it or achieve it. This is where the already, the term already, is the all-important Alibaba word. I am already that, which is already no thing. This is just a complete title change here, so we're just letting it settle in, that's all. This is the wisdom. A little time spent in full stop in the wow saves an enormous amount of time on the path, an enormous amount of time. I don't even know how to calculate it at all, but it really is the crucial step to take, is this full stop in the wow, and you give yourself a little time. You might just sit quietly for 5-10 minutes, and then a little quietly for a little longer, and just not seem to make any progress. But what it is, you're consolidating the progress you've already made. That's what's important, because we don't want to backtrack. And the ego will try to say, hey, you're not progressing. You were doing great there for a while, but what happened? And try to trick you. And they say, well, actually, what happened, ego? I was progressing so amazing, such tremendous progress, that I kind of need to take a time to consolidate it, get used to it, get familiar with it. Because the ego knows if it pushes you even further, you might start getting panicky, and then you might retreat and lose all the progress that you already made. So consolidating our progress is very important. So, yes, I already know I am that which can never be accomplished. Yes, I already know I am that which can never be achieved. Yes, I already know I am that which can never be acquired. Yes, I already know I am that which can never be attained. Yes, I already know I am that which can never be aligned. Tremendous weariness is coming upon me. Tremendous weariness. I have to be a spiritual marine, not collapse. You have to say, no, come on, let's keep the focus here. keep the pressure on. If all is God, what needs to be aligned? What alignments need to take place? What alignments need to take place, actually? See, I don't need it to be aligned. I don't need any alignments. All is already God. God is not the result of some alignments. So, we tend to view the world in terms of alignments, and ever more so with the technology of computers and measure, you know, number crunchers. We can discover all sorts of alignments in the stars and in the heavens, the cosmos. But if everything is already God, which it is, and nothing's ever been born, what need do we have for alignments, actually? Can anything be aligned? If there's only God, what is there to align with God? What is there to align with God? Nothing, right? There's nothing to align with God. God already is everything. So we don't need to be waiting for some alignment to take place, to be recognized, to notice, like, say, okay, I finally aligned with God. Does God need to align with God? Does truth need to align with truth? They say the path is difficult. Well, the golfers are playing this week at the Blue Monster in Doral, World Golf Championship, WGC, World Golf Championship. And all the top players in the world are there, and they built it up. Last year it was super difficult. They built it up. This is an incredibly difficult course. This is just, you know, it's just going to be brutal for them. And so I was expecting, oh wow, this is just, and here's somebody breezing along at like 8 under par through 12 holes. Someone else at 7. And, it's not difficult for them. But there are others who are like struggling, having a big lot of real high scores, having a lot of trouble. So you can't say that you know, the path is super difficult. It has degrees of difficulty, but there are some who, with the right frame of mind, can make it look easy, can make it look pretty easy. That doesn't mean that it won't be difficult for others. It's just a lot depends on concentration and focus and doing the right thing. So don't be intimidated by the lack of anybody, hardly anyone doing this. Maybe they were told it's so difficult that why even try? This is what I've gotten to say. Oh, you're going to do, what's your goal? Well, I'm going to be, I'm going to awaken from self-delusion. Oh, you know. What are you talking about? Only a few people done. Only like Buddha or Jesus or something. There hasn't been anybody else's. You just think you're going to do what they did? You're crazy. You know. In other words, they make it sound, the ego makes it sound like, well, it might be possible for like one or two, maybe just one. The ego prefers to say, well, yeah, just one did it, but that's the only one, and now it's shut for you. Somehow the one doing it has now shut it for everybody else. You know, the ego loves to think like that, to believe that way. And I said, no, it's difficult, but it's not that difficult. I mean, it's doable. And the ego loves to play up to saying, well, it's no, you know, it's you can't do it. The ego says, well, someone else might be super rare if anyone ever does it. And maybe those are just myths, and you know, possibly. But for you, are you kidding? Who are you trying to fool? You know, for you born person, a person who's born, you know, you have to have a very fortuitous birth, is what the ego says. It says the only way to realize truth is to have a very fortuitous birth. And no, the only way to realize truth is realize that you've never been born. Not that you've had a fortuitous birth, that you've never been born. No one's ever been born. How can we say the way to success is to have a fortuitous birth when the truth is that no one's ever been born? As soon as you accept the belief that you have to have a very fortuitous birth, then the ego will start talking about all this other stuff that has to be fortuitous for you. And then you realize, well, hey, none of this stuff is happening, seem to be happening for me, so I guess I'm just not one of the fortunate ones. See, the ego is one again. Nothing fortuitous has to happen. I've never been born. Nothing has been born. So why does something fortuitous have to happen? Everything is already unborn. It doesn't need anything fortuitous for it to be already unborn. It's already, it never was born. It doesn't need anything fortuitous to get back to the unborn state. Unbornness is not a state. It's the truth. It's the only truth there is. It's not a state. So there's nothing that needs to get back from one state to another to achieve some state change. Condition change. Everything is already in the one and only originalness, conditionness. Everything is already that. Yes, I already know everything is already that. Yes, I already know that everything is already that. Nothing has to be put back. You know, nothing has to be put back. Nothing's ever been taken out. Nothing has ever been taken out. Everything already is unborn. Everything already is unborn. Everything is already original nature. And, of course, because we're still perceiving, we use these dualistic terms, like unborn implies, well, as distinct from what born is, and original state as distinct from what non-original state. Of course, that can always be brought into it if we want to, but it doesn't have to be brought into it, as long as we understand that this is an intermediate step where we're still holding on to perception and faith, but using it in a different way, so we're not going to use it to confuse ourselves, obviously. You could, right? But it's a decision not to, that's all. So that's why we don't bring all this confusion in, because we could, but the whole point of it is to exercise discipline and decide, no, I'm not going to do that. I don't need to. Because the ultimate goal is to set down perception altogether. So what makes it easier? Obviously, to not be confused makes it easier. So that's the goal. So this practice, you know, just really is rough on the ego, isn't it? So that's fine. So there's a lot of wowness to it. It's like a severe workout. which is exactly what we need today, March 5th. We need the severity here. Need to indicate to the ego we're not playing games here. The ego will try to make a game out of it and refuse to play. No games. Nothing has ever been born. The ego will say, well, how can I play then? How can I play these games? You can't. Not interested in those games anymore. The ego says, well, but I have so many. Not interested. Not interested anymore. There are no games to play. Nothing has ever been born. So you cannot play the game of who is more born than what, you know, all the games of thingness and bornness and all this stuff, whatever. Well, ego says, well, how can we have a winner, achiever, an accomplisher, an acquirer, an attainer, an aligner? How can we have... you can't. Well, the ego says, well, we'll never be able to decide who's best. Who's best of what? The born? There is no born. How can you have the best of nothing? It's ridiculous. It's like an award show. So, well, folks, we're going to have an award show here, and we're going to present the best of nothing here for you. We'll determine which nothing is the best nothing. You know, it's ridiculous. Like, which zero is the best zero? Which zero is the more zero than any other zero? This is what the games the ego plays are really just simply these games, and that's why they don't really satisfy us. Do they? So wait a minute. They have all these zeros, and the ego says, "Okay, I'm going to shuffle all these up, man. You know, I want you to pick the one that's." What's the real zero, you know? What do you mean, real zero? Or the most important zero, the biggest zero? The most zero, the zeroest zero. They're all zero. What do you mean? Well, zero just means nothing. How can you have the best in nothing? Number one, nothing. The ego says, oh, this is putting me to sleep. The ego says, oh, I'm just going to sleep. I can't listen anymore to this. I'm just going to go to sleep. Well, we'll keep on going. Maybe, ego, you'll get enough energy to go to leave. And the ego says, not interested. I say, that's okay, you don't have to be interested. In fact, this will never interest you. So you're going to be bored to death with this. It has no interest to you whatsoever, right? The ego's all into, you know, hey, I got a game to play with these zeros. Who can stay born the longest? You know, there's never been any bornness, so... What kind of game is that? It's no game at all. It's ridiculous. or even saying who can stay unborn the longest, you know, is ridiculous. Everything is eternally unborn. And this is our relaxation, is the games the ego plays. We don't have to play them anymore. We don't have to be looking for any of those type of outcomes. Those type of outcomes don't exist. In fact, no outcomes exist at all. In truth, there are no outcomes. I'm sure the ego just liked that one too. Yes, I already know there are already no outcomes. Yes, I already know that there already are no outcomes. There are no outcomes. So, what am I doing waiting for an outcome? And so the idea of the ego saying, oh, you just don't like the outcome. Just wait for a little, wait a couple of years, 30 years, and we'll have a better outcome for you. Then you'll be willing to see it really is an outcome. No. Since there is no outcome right now, there never will be any outcome. What is waiting is just completely futile. It won't change anything. It won't change it at all. It's like saying waiting for zero to be something other than zero. That's not going to happen. That won't happen. So, have we wasted our lives waiting? Of course. That's the whole point, is to see we have wasted our lives. That's the best insight of all. Because then that's when you'll stop wasting. Because this isn't the only life we've wasted. Until you realize you've just wasted all your lives, you will continue with your lives. Continuing to waste your lives and not being aware of it. So, as soon as we realize, hey, yeah, I've just completely wasted my life. Great. Wonderful. You're waking up. This is not a sad thing. This is cause for celebration. This is cause for celebration. One moment. So it's a great cause for celebration. This is a great, so great, don't be scared of realizing, I've wasted my entire life. I've wasted, not just that, no, I've wasted all my lives. The entire time that I thought I was born, being born, I wasted all. It's all complete waste, total waste. Never happened. So I've just been thinking that something happened, which never happened, actually. Never can happen. So maturity comes when you're able to recognize you have been wasting your life and all your lives. Nothing but a waste. Nothing ever took place. Nothing ever happened. Nothing has ever happened. Not just your life, everyone's life. Nothing's ever happened, actually. Nothing has ever... Yes, I already know that nothing has ever happened. Yes, I already know that nothing has already happened. Yes, I already know that nothing has ever happened. Yes, I already know that nothing has ever happened. Yes, I already know that already nothing has ever happened. It's already the case. So if you want to burn, just say this over, nothing has ever happened, and feel this, that, and believe it, that nothing has ever happened. Nothing has ever happened. Yes, I already know that nothing has ever happened. Yes, I already know that nothing has ever happened. Yes, I already know that nothing has ever happened. Just feel the burn of that. Just feel the burn. It's a good day to realize this, because we're going to be, there's just a huge uptick. There's going to be a huge uptick in the idea of accomplishment and alignment. Accomplishment, achievement, attainment, acquirement. There's going to be this huge uptick as we have been going through this for quite some time in the world, but it's going to keep accelerating. And so to offset that, the best way is this burn, full stop, in the wow, and of this burn of nothing has ever happened. Nothing has ever happened. There's no need, no teacher, no teaching, no student. Or no student, no teacher, and no teaching. Just rest in the realization, nothing has ever happened. Nothing has ever been attained. Nothing has ever been accomplished. Nothing has ever been acquired. Nothing has ever been aligned. Nothing has ever been achieved. Because nothing's ever been born. Nothing has ever changed. Nothing has ever changed. God has not changed in the slightest bit, so how can we say that there is any sort of attainment, achievement, accomplishment, acquirement, alignment? So nothing has ever happened. No change has ever taken place. In the nature of reality, no change has ever taken place. A 144, what I'm saying, yeah. Looking at this one, 144. Practice, the number of practice. Which is what we're doing here. So this reaching series like this, and you know, it's having this space probe go into orbit around it for all this time, and you know, is something that the world is going to feel like, in a sense of accomplishment, attainment, and all of this which will simply feed into the overall situation, zeitgeist of the world, the overall situation, that to boost the belief in yes, we can attainment, you know, yes, we can achieve, yes, we can accomplish, yes, we can acquire, yes, we can align. All of this will get stronger and stronger. And this is, you know, this is the root of delusion. So it's like we're fertilizing this tree of delusion to an extraordinary extent, trying to get it, you know, get it to bloom, and except the fruits are inedible, basically. You know, the tree looks, oh, look at this tree, look at all these fruits, and then we try to eat the fruit, and it's rotten. It's rotten. The fruits of the tree of the ego are rotten fruits. They only look good superficially, but you can't eat them. And so, yet we're busy fertilizing this tree. We're busy fertilizing it and watering it and trying to stimulate, you know, boom, some huge crop of rottenness. So the more we can go through this burn and put in your time, put in your effort, put in and put yourself through this mini ordeal, then you realize, oh, it's not so bad. I can do that again, or I can, next time it won't even be so bad, or I can do it even more intense now. I feel I can handle the greater intensity of it, and therefore you go towards realization of what? God as world, instead of world as world. And this is liberation, plain and simple. When you see God as world, you are liberated from self-delusion. Don't worry about all this complexities of the jhanas, you know, the all the meditative states, that, you know, all this delineation of so many different mental states you can be in. And this is what Buddha went through, all the jhanas, was it like 9 of them or something, and some say there's a 10th, and finally he said it doesn't work. And then he remembered the first one when he was young. He says, oh yeah, that's the first one, was that's the actual one that we need, and that's all we need, and then that's it. This was the, you know, the big discovery. We only need to see God as world. That's it. Then there isn't any born one to attain enlightenment, you see? There isn't any born one to attain enlightenment. There isn't any attainment. It's the belief in attainment, which is the delusion, that right? There isn't any one that is born that needs to make attain a change to get back to what they were. We've never lost what we are, how we were created. We've never changed what we are, what is. What God created can never be changed. So there's never been a change. So there's nothing that needs to attain at all. No attainment necessary. No attainment possible. And so just hearing this and going through the burn of this is super helpful for all of us. What if we were in the days ahead to meet the Buddha, for instance, meet Jesus, meet Ramana Maharshi, meet whatever, they would say something quite similar, actually. You're already that which can never be attained. And we'd say, yes, I already know. I am already that which can never be attained. I already know In other words, I've already gotten used to hearing this and letting it permeate my being. Yes, I already know that I'm already that which can never be attained, which is unattainable. I'm already that which is unaccomplishable. I'm already that which is unacquirable. Yes, I already know I'm already that which is unachievable. Yes, I already know that I'm already that which is unalignable. So we're already take this in and have, you know, let the ego has departed. Say, can't stand this anymore. So a lot of that can't stand that is already gone. So when we hear it, we just say, yeah, that's great. Lovely music. This is what I want to hear. Whereas those who haven't done this, the ego's still entrenched, very much entrenched, and they'll say to the Buddha, you know, for example, hey, why don't you go tell someone else this? Why don't you go over to those people over there? Why are you telling me this? Why don't you go over there and tell them that? You know, this is what they will say, because the ego in them is like screaming, like, get away from this crazy lunatic. I can't stand him. If you don't get away from this crazy lunatic, I'm going to leave you. We say, oh, no, ego. We need your advice on how to achieve. No, you can't leave me, you know. Okay, get away, Buddha. Go, get out of here. I don't want to listen to you. This is terrible. The ego says it's going to leave me. This is what happens. This is what will happen. And then they'll claim, well, you just got lucky. You're not lucky, right? As they say, you make your own luck. Again, don't despair. Remember, opening the eyes, meaning the perceptual shift, is the last step. So you may be succeeding tremendously. It's just the ego tries to give a false yardstick to measure it by. The ego says, well, you haven't even opened your eyes yet. Man, what are you talking about, progress? No, opening the shift of perception is the last step. It's the last step. All the groundwork, the foundation, the house, the framing, everything is done. That's done first. So that we're doing all the hard work first. Whereas the ego thinks it takes the opposite tack and think we haven't done anything because our eyes are still not, we haven't shifted our perception yet. So that's another way that undermines the path. The ego's measurement of our path is completely backwards. And of course the ego says, if you don't accept my measurement, I'm going to leave you. Then how are you going to achieve? Oh no, ego, please. I don't want to be a nobody. I don't want to be failure. I want to accomplish something. I want to achieve. I want to acquire. Want to align. I want to attain something. Please, ego, I must attain. I must attain to something. And the ego says, "Well, I'll show you how. If you stop listening, you know that." Listen to this craziness. I can't stand this stuff. And you see in the world now, you know, reading some of the comments on you know, comment section on art, you know, whatever article or something on the internet, something that allows comments, you know. And what was it yesterday? I was reading something that really, really brought out, wow, the difference in the world right now. And it's so severe. Basically, those who go with the ego are just saying, hey, I can't stand this. I can't stand, you know, what you're saying. This is really what it's now gotten to. Is the ego within them saying, I can't tolerate anything that disagrees with my viewpoint. So just get away from me, you know, get away. Stay away. Don't ever come back. You know, this is why it's a breakdown of civility in the world. This is what's happening. Is more and more people embrace the ego and think that's the way to go. Materialism is the way to go, they think. Is accomplishment, achievement, all this, they think that's it. Instead of trusting in God, that God is all and all is God. the ego just tells them, hey, you've got to absolutely reject this viewpoint entirely and get away from it and don't ever, you know, associate it with whatsoever. So we're having this, you know, in the internet, people are just talking past one another, and especially for those who have intensely, you know, harboring the ego in an intense manner, they just cannot tolerate any differing opinion than their own. They believe everything that they believe is socially the right, is right. All the social engineering they're doing is some sort of absolute truth that anyone who disagrees with it, it is absolutely horrible person, and they don't want to have anything to do with them. You know, the ego can't stand it. Their ego can't stand it. And the ego terrifies them by telling them, hey, if you listen to this stuff about God, I'm going to leave you because I can't stand it. And the problem is, the more dependent you become on the ego, the more powerless you feel, and the more frightened the ego gets, you know, and more demanding it gets. First, the ego seems like just little demands, and then the demands increase, because the ego's always incredibly, totally insecure, because it feels that you have the power to leave it. So it keeps threatening to leave you, and bringing up this idea of you need to accomplish, you need to become the self, you need to be, and the ego says that it's the guide, it's God-appointed guide to help you do this. This is what the ego says, and this is what we believe. Are completely ridiculous. There's nothing we need to achieve. So why do we need a guide to achievement, so to speak? The Holy Spirit is an advisor, but it advises us to the truth that we don't need to achieve anything. And that realization is not an achievement. See, that's why when we get glimpses, then we come to the ego and say, hey, ego, look what you did. I got this glimpse of reality. It's great. And the ego says, uh-oh, you know, this is bad news, but I better play it cool. Say, wow, you know, how'd you do that? Let's look into how you did it, and what were the kind of thoughts you were having before you had it? And what about the thoughts before them? And what about the thoughts before them? And you say, well, I can't quite trace it back that far. And the ego goes, what? This is important, the ego says. You got to be able to trace this back further. Come on, well, you think about it some more. And so then your mind is completely blocked and trying to remember like a chain of thoughts that led to, you know, what led up to this? And I'm completely confused, ego. I got to admit, I can't remember. And the ego says, oh, it's awful. Well, you know, the ego says, maybe you need to work on better achievement then, you know, we'll try again. And, you know, totally dissipate the whole situation that way. So enlightenment is not an achievement. It's not an attainment. It's actually dropping desire for achievement, dropping desire for attainment. I already know I don't need to attain anything. Yes, I already know that there's nothing I need to attain. Yes, I already know there's nothing I need to achieve. I'm already that which is unattainable. I'm already that which is unattainable. I'm already that which is unattainable. Okay, well, we're going towards a couple hours on this video, and I'm going to have to do some, I'm going to have to do some work, actually, come right about now. So, you know, we are pushing things as fast as possible here, so realize it's somewhat of a mini ordeal, but it's very important to see clearly, you know, what we're talking about here in terms of, you know, no achievement, nothing's ever happened, nothing's ever been born. Therefore, achievement's impossible. Accomplishment's impossible. Nothing has changed, ever. God is still all. It's very important to get this out right now because of the uptick in in the belief that we're what we are human beings, accomplishers. Look what we have accomplished, and all this kind of stuff. This is the last thing that we need to hear. So we have this alternative here to hear this now. So okay, very great. Looks like we've reached 2 hours, and we're going to stop it right here. And who knows, later on tonight I may be able to do another one. So very great. Just stay full stop in the wow as we walk together in the wow.